Hello, I'm Graham and I hope everyone's having a great day and welcome to today's video. Now today's video is really a continuation of my previous video where we were looking at getting better macro pictures using your Panasonic Lumix Micro Four Thirds camera. Now the same situation can apply with Micro Four Thirds as it can with the Canon EOS M series cameras. You can use the extension tubes on the Canon series to get exactly the same results as I'm doing here with this Panasonic GX85 camera. Now today I want to try and show you how to focus stack your images so you can get greater depth of field if your camera aperture doesn't allow you to create that amount of depth of field. Now it may be that you're taking a product shot for advertising something on eBay and you want to get the whole of the product sharp from foreground to the background. You might not be able to get that even with the smallest aperture of your lens. And if you do stop down to the lowest aperture, you'll find that you probably get a little bit of softening due to a phenomenon called diffraction. Now, with the Micro Four Thirds system, the diffraction isn't as great as it is with the 1/2-inch FZ200 or FZ330 type cameras, but we still run into diffraction from about f8 onwards, so it's better to avoid the 11, 16 and 22 apertures if you can. But it does depend on the type of image you're producing and where you're going to use them as to whether that will affect your final image. Now today I want to show you how to focus stack using a variety of methods. First of all, the in-camera post-focus method. Then we'll be using a facility that the Panasonic and the Olympus cameras have where we can actually do a focus bracket mode. Now, if your camera doesn't supply either focus bracketing or post-focus, we can actually look at using what's called a focus rail. And the focus rail allows you to move the camera in increments through your subject to enable you to capture a sequence of events which you can then combine into a final image. Now I've got set up on the bench here a simulation of what you might be trying to achieve outdoors. I've got a ladybird that's inside a plant. Actually this is a wooden ladybird and it's probably about twice life size. So to capture this I'm using a 16mm extension tube on my 14-45 kit lens with this GX85 camera. Now if you're using it at life size for a real size ladybird you might want to add the 10mm extension here to give you a larger enlargement, or if you're using the supplementary lenses you might need to use the number 4 and the number 2 combination to give you the magnification that you need. Anyway, we're going to deal with the situation first where we've got a 16mm lens, my kit lens, and you can see the working distance from the lens to the subject is about 50mm, just 2 inches. Well, the depth of field is just about 4 or 5mm, which is probably just enough to capture this ladybird, but you may be trying to capture insects with a greater depth than that. Maybe their antennae you want to get in focus as well as the back of the image. So again, you'd need to be using a focus stack to enable you to achieve this. So let's look at the image that's already coming from the camera. I'll just switch over the view and you can see this ladybird. You've got the front of it is in focus, but the background is out of focus. And I want to try and capture this ladybird in its entirety. So the front and back of it are sharp. At the moment my aperture is f16 and we'll lock the slide so it doesn't move. I'm going to set the 2-second timer. So at the moment I've got the focus set just before the ladybird and I want to try and capture the background. So let's just take that picture at f16. And you can see it's almost in full focus but there's still a little bit that's going to be out of focus. So let's step the camera down to f22. That's the minimum aperture that this lens supports. And I'm expecting it to look a little bit soft when we look at it in the full edit suite. So yeah, we've got a complete range of focus there. So that's probably about 7 or 8mm worth of depth of field at f22. We can probably get a sharper image if we use a wider aperture. We will get less of the diffraction taking place, so we should be able to get a sharper image, but we'll then need to use a focus stack technique to enable us to capture all of that image from the foreground to the background in perfect sharpness. So the first method we're going to look at is the in-camera post-focus mode. Now unfortunately I can't use the HDMI out at the same time as post-focus, it just doesn't allow you to do that. So we're going to have to look at the view from an overhead camera and look at the back of the camera to see the effect. So let me first of all switch over to the overhead view from the iPhone 11. I'll try and get this down a little bit closer to the screen, like so. So what I want to do is to set up the menu to give me the post focus. So into the menu in the setup mode. You notice we've got post focus and you need to turn that on. So select on. Now when you come back to the shooting screen, the camera will actually take a series of images all the way through the 49 area method that it provides. It's actually making an MP4 file, and then from that MP4 file you will actually select the image set that you want to create that still image. If you notice on screen, I've got my aperture set to f5.6. I've had to raise the ISO to 400 so that I can get the shutter speed within range for this particular example. So the aperture is f5.6, which is pretty good for this kit lens to give me a fairly sharp result. So again, I've got my 2 second timer, and when I start the sequence, the camera will then step through the 49 area and record the whole of that image. So let's start the process. You can see that it says recording in post focus, and it's gone through and it's captured a 1 second file of all the focus points. Now if we use the function 3 key or press the screen here and I use auto merging, it will arrange those areas and post focus stack them for us. So it's creating a single image from all those focus points that are deemed to be in focus, so it should give us a nice focus stacked image. It takes about 30 seconds for us to do this. You can see on the edit screen now we've got the image from the camera that produced that result. So that is using the in-camera post focus. Remember, it's only using an 8 megapixel size image to produce the end result. So if that's large enough for your needs, then that's great. If not, then you need to use the full resolution and then use the focus bracketing mode to enable you to capture full size images. I'm capturing here at 16:9 with this camera, so that'll be giving me a 12 megapixel image. So let's set up to do the focus bracketing mode, and I'll show you how to accomplish that. So you can see here that I'm using the standard photo style. I'm using 16:9, which gives me a large JPEG 12 megapixel image. My quality is fine JPEG, and I'm going to go through to the bracket mode. So you'll find this in your setup screen. You need to turn this on and then select the focus method. So once you've selected focus, it will then give you some more options. So the three options to set are, first of all, the step, and you can change the step value from 1 to 10, and each of those step values will move the lens closer or further away from the subject dependent how you've got the sequence set. Now there's no set dimensions for each of those steps. It will depend on the lens you're using as to how much the lens focus point will change per each step. You can also set the number of images from 2 to 999, so it gives you a complete range of options there. And the sequence you can change from, if I just step through here, from the current focus and then increment towards the background, or you can use the other option, which is from the current focus and then it will step one step closer and one step further, then it will step two steps closer and two steps further, three steps, four steps, etc. But I find that image sequence quite difficult to try and sort out when I want to stack the images. So what I tend to do is use the plus and zero, so I know that I'm going to go from my closest point to my furthest point when I use this facility. Now I'm going to be using a step sequence of plus 4 for this and 30 image steps. So it gives me a step from the front of the image all the way through to the back of the image, and sometimes you want to include some more foreground and some more background, so you can actually select in your image stacking program the exact number of images with the right sharpness that you require. So in this, by experimentation, I've determined that plus 4 is ideal for this setup. So come back to the main screen, And I'm going to set my initial focus point to just before the ladybird. So I'm going to tap on screen and the camera will focus. I'm using the AFS mode here, but it doesn't really matter for this sequence. So AFS is the method I've used. So I've set my focus point here. Now when I operate the camera, it will use that image sequence we've selected. So it'll do a step increment of 4 and it will make 30 images from here all the way to the background. So within that sequence we should have enough depth of field to cover it. So let me start that going and you should see it in operation. Again, I've got that 2 second timer set and you can hear the camera stepping through, probably just see on screen where it's going through in focus, and you can see on here the countdown. Now I'm using the electronic shutter to capture these images. You can use the mechanical shutter if you like, but that obviously introduces a little bit more wear. So I've got the electronic shutter set to provide that increment. So we've got our now 30 images of 12 megapixel resolution with varying degrees of sharpness. We'll import those into our image editing program such as Helicon Soft or Photoshop or Syrene, and we can combine them to give us our final image. Now I said there was another method you could use, and that is using a focus rail to enable you to move the camera and the lens combination across the image to capture a series of slices which you can then combine to give you a single image. I have various macro focus rails and I'll show you those in another video, but I can show you here on this slider because I've got a scale that I've sellotaped to the bottom of the slider and it enables me to move it in whatever increments that I want to capture this image. I'm going to choose to use 1 millimeter. So I've got the camera set up in the manual focus mode. So I'm going to take it to the point where I want the first picture to be, take that picture, then I'll move it forward by 1 millimeter, and then move it again by 1 millimeter and take another picture and step my way through until I've got all the pictures I need for this sequence. Now, normally I'll be using a remote release, but there'd be too many things on the desk to contend with. So I'm going to be pressing the shutter at each time to capture those images. So let me switch over to the output from the camera. So this method of the slider allows us to move the camera backwards and forwards, and then we can take slices through the image all the way to the background. So I want to start with the camera in manual focus mode and set it just a little bit ahead of the first point of focus that I want. I've got the 2 second timer set up so I can capture the image without shake. So let's take that first image. Then I'm going to take the next image by moving the camera another 1 millimeter closer. So we've gone into the image by 1 millimeter, and again take that second image. Then move the camera in by 1 millimeter and take the third image. You can probably just see the different areas coming up in focus on the screen. I'll take it further by another millimeter. Take the next shot. Then move the camera again by another millimeter. You can see now we're progressing to the back of this little model ladybird. Take the next shot, and then we'll cover that by going just to the back of the ladybird and take another shot. So we've got all those images now. We can stack again in our program like Photoshop, Helicon Soft or Syrene, whatever, and you can then combine those images. Now, one of the problems you may come across when you're using this focus rail method is that the front entrance pupil of the lens is moving every time you take the picture. So the actual perspective is changing as you're taking the picture, and when you try and combine those in your stacking program, you may find you're getting stacking artifacts because there are multiple images and the field of view is effectively changing. Dedicated macro lenses tend to keep the front node in the same position and you're just changing the focus point. So we're likely to run into some stacking artifacts when we try to combine this in our image edit program. It depends on the actual lens you're using, the focal length of it, and the distance from the lens to the subject just to how much this will interfere with the stacking program. So it's best to try it before you go into any large production with it. So hopefully that's given you some ideas of how to use focus stacking with your Panasonic Lumix cameras and your lenses with either extension tubes or supplementary lenses. Now, Olympus are at the head of the game with this sort of focus stacking. They actually give you a facility in their automated sequence of putting a delay between each shot. And that allows you to use electronic flash and allow the flash to recharge between each shot. So it does an exposure with the flash allows the flash to charge and then does another exposure. So you can actually do a fully automated sequence with flash to give you that macro image. Using the Panasonic camera, then you'd have to use a remote control, let the flash charge and then take your shot. You can't use it in an automated sequence. In the next video, we'll be looking at using some additional lighting to give you this macro imaging. You might want to use flash, or you might want to use additional LED lighting to give you enough light on your subject to give you enough depth of field. So I look forward to bringing you that in the next video. So as usual, if you're a new viewer and you're liking what you see, do click that subscribe button and the bell notification icon to be advised when I upload any new images in this series. Also, check out my photographic blog. I'll put a link to that in the video description below. My photographic blog's got lots more information on Panasonic Lumix bridge cameras, the Micro Four Thirds system, and on the EOS M range. Also, on the homepage of the blog is the application form to join my newsletter group, and that newsletter is really a technical publication in its own right, and it goes out to 3,500 people every 3 or 4 weeks, depending on what time I have to put that together. So if you're not already subscribed to that, fill out that application form, which gives me the authority to email you, and you'll receive it in the next issue. So, thanks again for watching. Please do take care, and don't forget to like and subscribe if you do like this video. So until the next one, thanks very much for watching. Please do take care, and I hope to see you all in my next one. Goodbye for now.